Hello and welcome to Dental Studies Simplified. I'm Dr. Ankita Kotecha and today's topic is decision making about interleukin-1 genetic testing. Interleukin-1 genetic testing is not advisable in every periodontal patient. So in today's video, we will discuss when to advise interleukin-1 genetic testing and what are its applied aspects. So mainly interleukin-1 genetic testing helps in determination of the risk for future disease progression. Talking about the risk predictors, the main predictors or rather the strongest predictor of future disease progression is the past history of periodontitis. So there are mainly clinical signs of periodontitis which includes past history of periodontitis and recurrent gingival bleeding. Now why past history of periodontitis? Because a past history of periodontitis validates that patient is susceptible to disease. It indicates that patient at some point of time had inadequate oral hygiene, that is why it led to the initiation of the disease. And thirdly, the disease has brought in the anatomical and biochemical changes which made the oral hygiene maintenance further difficult. That is why the past history of periodontitis is the strongest predictor of periodontal disease in future. Recurrent gingival bleeding, we all know that it is a good indicator of future disease, but its absence is an excellent indicator of disease stability. That is why these two clinical signs of periodontal disease have to be evaluated. Secondly, the modifiable risk factors such as smoking and diabetes. We all know it is a very well validated relationship between smoking and periodontitis and diabetes and periodontitis, or three of them together. Clear? But the most neglected part is the non-modifiable risk factors, genetics. You must be surprised to know that almost 50% of the case variations can be attributed to the genetic variations. Although there are various genes that have been studied in periodontal disease and they have been attributed or correlated, but till date only interleukin-1 genetic testing is acceptable. It is the only gene variation that is validated in long-term trials, and that is why we are talking about interleukin-1 genetic testing. We'll discuss when to advise interleukin-1 genetic testing and what are its applied aspects. So a periodontal disease patient must be evaluated for risk assessment. Accordingly, patient will be categorized into low, moderate or high risk patient. Low risk category patient is somebody who does not have past history of periodontal disease, no smoking and no diabetes. So to summarize, clinical signs of periodontitis are absent, modifiable risk factors are absent, so no need of interleukin-1 genetic testing. Simple. Here no need of interleukin-1 genetic test. But if the patient has one of the following predictors of future periodontal disease present, then they must be evaluated for interleukin-1 genetic testing, and accordingly they will be categorized into moderate or high risk category patients. Now interleukin-1 genetic kit commercially available as PST, periodontal screening test, or any other kit available, they must be performed. So ideally a saliva sample or a buccal swab sample is collected and sent to the laboratory for its evaluation using its own supplies and instructions. Clear? They will give us the results in form of positive or negative. So now what to do with those results? Those results are now incorporated into the present data and finally they are categorized into moderate or high risk category. So now we will discuss what are the case scenarios which will be categorized as moderate or high risk categories. So a moderate risk category patients are such which has one of the predictors positive. See, we have four predictors of future periodontal disease: past history of periodontitis, smoking, diabetes and genetics. So if the patient is either current smoker, please listen carefully, It is one of the following: either current smoker or diabetic or history of periodontitis. But interleukin test is negative. Then they are moderate risk category patients. Conversely, if they are non-smoker, non-diabetic, no history of periodontitis, but interleukin test is positive, then also they are categorized as moderate risk category patients. So overall, one of the predictors of the future periodontal disease is positive, be it modifiable risk factor, the past history of periodontitis, that is clinical signs of periodontitis, or the genetic testing. Either one of the following should be positive. So in the first case scenario, genetic testing is negative, but the patient is positive for either of the modifiable risk factors or the clinical signs of periodontitis. And in the second case scenario, patient is positive for the genetic testing but negative for the modifiable risk factors or clinical signs of periodontitis. So if the patient is positive for one predictor of future periodontal disease, then they are categorized in moderate risk category. And high risk category patients are positive for two predictors of periodontal disease. Now what are those two? They have to be one, that is either they are current smoker or they are diabetic or they have a history of periodontitis, that is they are positive for one of the following plus they are interleukin 1 positive. Such patients are high risk category patients. So this is how interleukin 1 genetic testing helps us in risk stratification of the patients. Very quickly, low risk category patients are somebody who are neither smokers, neither diabetics, nor they have a past history of periodontal disease. So such patients are low risk category patients which do not require genetic testing. But if these low risk category patients at subsequent visits presents with bleeding on protein, that is recurrent gingival bleeding, which is again a predictor of future periodontal disease, then they must be recategorized to moderate risk category patients and evaluated for genetic testing. And that is why we have one of those case scenarios where the patient is a non-smoker, non-diabetic, no history of periodontitis, but interleukin 1 genetic testing positive. That case scenario is because a former low risk category patient is now recategorized to moderate risk category patients and hence indicated for genetic testing, which came out to be positive. So this is how interleukin 1 genetic testing helps us in risk stratification. Talking about the role of now interleukin 1 genetic testing and accordingly the risk stratification on the maintenance visit. So again, the low risk, moderate risk and high risk patients. So the low risk patients will be evaluated every 12 months provided bleeding on probing is absent. If bleeding on probing is present, that is recurrent gingival bleeding at 2 visits, then they must be evaluated every 6 months. Their visits must be rescheduled to every 6 months till bleeding on probing gets absent. Whereas for moderate risk category patients, they must be evaluated every 6 months provided bleeding on probing is absent. If they are stable for the next 2 visits, that is 2 visits, bleeding on probing is absent, then they can be rescheduled. Their visits can be rescheduled to every 12 months. This is how this risk stratification will help in the visits, maintenance visits. And the high risk patients must be reevaluated every 3-4 months till bleeding on probing is absent. Once bleeding on probing is absent at 2 visits, they can be reevaluated every 5 to 6 months. Clear? This is how The role of interleukin-1 genetic testing and the risk stratification helps in our treatment plan considerations and framing the subsequent maintenance visits. So this is how interleukin-1 genetic testing and the accordingly risk stratification will help in determining the supportive parenteral therapy visits. This completes the topic interleukin-1 genetic testing. A quick summary, when to advise interleukin-1 genetic testing, it is when the patient is positive for one of the predictors of future parenteral disease, that is either past history of parenteral disease or diabetes or a smoker, any one of the following. Then the patient must be evaluated more closely with interleukin-1 genetic testing, which is performed with its commercially available kit, example PST. A saliva sample or a buccal swab sample is collected and the test results are available to us in the form of either positive or negative. So now, if the patient is positive for any of the following predictors of parenteral disease but interleukin-1 negative, then they are moderate risk category. If the patient is negative for any of the predictors of parenteral disease but interleukin-1 positive, then also they are moderate risk category. And if the patient is positive for one of the predictors of parenteral disease and that is both the predictors of parenteral disease present and interleukin-1 genetic testing positive, that is both are positive, then they are high risk category patients. So this is how interleukin-1 genetic testing helps us in risk stratification and accordingly its implications on the treatment plan, treatment response and framing the supportive parenteral therapy visits. I hope the topic is clear to you all, but if you still have any doubts or any queries, feel free to ask me in the comment section below or mail me at my email ID dentalstudiesimplified@gmail.com. Thank you for watching and listening to me. Study well, have a good day, stay safe.